topic will be fever with rash. Over to you, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Audible, sir. Audible.
Respected teachers, Dr. Abesha, Dr. Baldev Prajapati sir, Dr. Srinivasan sir, and other dignitaries and other faculty members, including my student Dr. Manjusha, and the office bears of the IEP Tamil Nadu branches. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Abesha for giving me this opportunity to talk on fever with rash, a very common problem in our day-to-day practice. We are seeing many patients with or without fever, we are seeing rashes. But when we are seeing fever with rash, we are thinking about two, three conditions. First one is, commonest one is infection. Second one is non-infectious condition, like especially collagen vascular disease. Third thing, nowadays very common is drug rash. Drug rash got both, it is a very implication. Especially, it will create some medical legal issues also. So we should be very careful about such a drug rash. Another important aspect is that what we want to say that whether child is sick or not. So sometimes it will give a clue regarding whether child is very sick or very active, stable, then we can plan management accordingly. And the last one is that the importance of the isolation of a patient. Many patients make the rash, chickenpox, measles. You have to diagnose, that's important, but we have to isolate the patients also. That is also another important. So with this fever, I will go to my first slide. So it's a basics of our MBBS days, third year MBBS days. So we make it different types of rash present terminology. Macus means it's a flat lesion, the size is any size, but a spatule is the elevated lesion of less than 0.5 centimeter. Nodule is more large and more deeper. It's not only large, but also deeper also. Pustule means it will be something contained pus. So when the lesion is on the skin, we'll call it is a exanthematous. When we'll call it is a mucous membrane, we'll call it say another. Again, we'll get a vesicle and a bulla. Vesicle means by definition, fluid contained less than 0.5 centimeter. Bulla is large one. Estrum is a dead necrotic tissue. Nowadays, it's very common to see with the rickettsial infection. And also, when it is a scab, that means it is already dead tissue. Particularly, means hives, following drugs or some simple bile fever. Purpura and ecchymosis means again less than 0.5 centimeter purpura. Some people will call it is a petty case if it's less than 0.3 centimeter. Then, if it's a large one, we call it is a ecchymosis. So, we have to means a fever and rash will give to diagnose to you. How can you diagnose a case of SLE or dermatomyositis without rash? You can easily diagnose a tenosynovial purpura with the rash, measles, chickenpox, everything you can rash with, you can diagnose with the rash. So rash will brings out the fever. So diagnosis is very easy. So you have to look for certain features of rash, diagnostic rash. Yes, so you already mentioned dermatomyositis, you get a heliotropic rash, SLE, you get a butterfly rash, you get HSP, you get a rash, distribution rash, lower limb. So all these things are very familiar to us. So once in a while, we have to do attention to all these conditions. So for example, morbid rash in the case of measles type of rash, vesicular and bulla, chickenpox, even hand foot mouth disease also, we are seeing the bulla lesion, scarlet and deformed fever lesion, and also not only a rash, associated features. We all know 3C of measles, coryza, conjunctivitis, and a cough, it's very, we know everything. And what is a desquamation following the rash, arthritis, joint pain. So all this will give you very definite. So associated features are very important. And the mucosal involvement, some of them will involve mucosa. For example, Stevens-Johnson syndrome will involve the mucosa. Some others will involve particularly mucosa. You get a characteristic lesion in the SLE in the mouth without painful, painless, painful lesion like that. And the distribution of progress and the transformation also very important. I already mentioned about certain features. The key sign of certain rash will get the diagnosis. Again, measles will appear first in the face, chicken box is centripetal distribution. HSP will get a lower limb distribution. So very useful. We are seeing all this. We are very familiar with all this condition also. And a day of appearance also. When the classic description, first day, we used to say first day, varicella, second day, scarlet, fifth day, typhus, seventh day, typhus, But no, there may be some pitch, maybe variation, because especially with the use of some bacterial infection, antibiotic, there may be some changes. But roughly, it may help to diagnose. And the more concerned is whether child is stable or very unstable. We know certain conditions like dengue fever may be sometimes stable, or some condition you may get with the unstable patient also. Meningococcal sometimes it may be tell me. So according to the severity also you are assessed by using the criteria. So as per seriousness, as I already mentioned, you may get a very serious condition, toxic shock syndrome, cephalococcus calda syndrome, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, and meningococcus. We know all of them are very, very serious, and we have to give due attention without wasting any time. And some conditions may be self-limiting, for example, measles, even hand, foot, mouth disease, rubella, even simple case of chicken box also, you can say it is a comparatively very simple and benign. Sometimes it may be very serious also. And different undifferentiated conditions like dengue fever and the rickettsial infection, you may get a simple infection, but it may be very serious also according to the associated complication. Drug rash also, we are concentrating too much on drug rash also today. So if you have rash with the unstable event day, then you have to think about signs of some other systemic inflammatory response and shock. And you have to see for multi-organ. And especially nowadays, this COVID season, even though there is no definite rheumatologic features of COVID, but you are suspecting with certain skin lesion COVID also. So what are the more important, the common lesion? Here it is very characteristic. It's an infant. You can see burns like, scald like lesion, you can see that. And you can see the mucosa is comparatively involved. There is no lesion around the lips and the mouth. So can you just say cephalococcus scald skin syndrome, a very, very serious condition. It may occur generally in infancy or less than 5 years. And it is produced by toxin by cephalococcus. So it is a very toxin mediated one. And as I already mentioned, it may not involve the mucosa. At positive Nicolas sign, you can see the peeling of skin, you can see that. That is called suppression of this one. The pressure is called Nicolas sign. And diagnosis may be bacterial culture, because you may not get bacteria because it is a toxin mediated, late feature. So you won't get it. Blood culture may be negative also. And as already mentioned, no mucosa involvement, that is a very characteristic feature when compared to other lesions. Then you go to second case. Is to a trivial injury of a right toe following a painful swelling. He's a 6-year-old boy and comparatively better, but 7 days he had high grade fever, malaise, vomiting, and a severe prostration. So, on examination, generalized erythematous maculopapular rash, cold extreme, that is, he has stroke, and he got a tachycardia, BP lower side, SpO2 also in the lower side. So, there is a multi system involvement in a child, 6-year-old child with involvement. And after 3 days admission, patient develops facial edema further. So there is an involvement of other system also, skin pruritus, painful erythema. So in such a condition, in a 6-year-old boy, after a minor injury and a developing multi-system, you have to think about toxic shock syndrome. Again, another serious condition. So there are certain criteria for toxic shock syndrome. So body temperature, hypothermia, so hypotension, diffuse macular erythema and disc commotion. Our child got all the three features. It was there. Disc commotion is not mentioned because afterwards it developed 1 to 2 weeks after. Then there is this involvement of three or more organ system. There may be vomiting and diarrhea. There may be varying degree of severe body ache and CPK may be high. Involvement of the muscle system. The mucous membrane hyperemia is another important because unlike in SSS here, mucous membrane also involved. And there will be kidney failure and also. Yes, a liver involvement in the form of Fraser enzymes, and you may get a thrombocytopenia and a central nervous system involvement in the form of confusion without any focal neurologic signs. So here in our child, we may get a negative result of a blood, the throat, and CSF culture for other bacteria, and also negative serology for rickettsia infection, leptospirosis. All these conditions you have to think about, because you have to think about bacterial infection, you have to think about rickettsial infection, you have to think about other serious condition. So all these things you have to keep in mind. In our patient, the CBC, there is a leukocytosis, hemoglobin normal, and the platelet also normal. CRIK protein is high, ESR means moderately high, and SGPT, blood urea, creatinine, all are in the rising trend. and urine routine also showing 5 to 6 pulses, and blood and urine culture were sent. So what is the most common bug here? Because it's a Torg-Steroff syndrome. Traditionally, two main organisms implicated are, one is Streptococcus pyogenes and second one is Streptococcus aureus. Even though it is described early in infants with Streptococcus pyogenes, later it is more described in young adults and girls with the use of sanitary measures, because it's a problem with the poor, means unhygienic use of it. That is why they got a very famous, means well described with the young adults and girls. In our case, the blood culture Streptococcus pyogenes are isolated and later treated with antibiotics. This is a comparatively easy case, but nowadays we are not commonly seeing because of the whether it is due to increased use of vaccination or due to overuse of antibiotics. So in this particular rash, you can see the very confined region, more in the axilla and legs, confluence of lesion you can see here, and hemorrhagic patches also. So you can see small rash and large confluence lesion also. And the really important thing is that you can get the scraping for gram staining. Yeah, in our case, it's a gram-native diplococcus. I diagnose it very easy. So it's very important, meningococcemia, the diagnosis of meningococcemia, because treatment is very important. But one thing, either when we are doing a CSF examination or when we are seeing such a case, we are sending the blood and the CSF for the lab, but many times we are forgetting about the gram staining. So gram staining either from such a skin lesion or CSF, it will give gram positive coca, gram negative coca, gram positive bacilli. So you'll get diagnosed within 10 to 15 minutes with each organism. Meningococcemia is very serious condition. You got a serious spectrum. It may be very serious in the form of purpura permanens. You may get meningitis. You may get meningococcemia more severe. And also when there is adrenal involvement, you get a Waterhouse Friderichsen syndrome. So timely diagnosis and early antibiotics is very crucial. And you go to next case, it is a 10-year-old boy present with a history of fever of 10 days duration, abdominal pain 4 days, and sore throat for 4 days. So some sore throat, abdominal pain, and fever, child had received some oral medication for this symptom. He developed a rash after 24 hours involving palms and soles and trunk and oral cavity. So all he developed a rash like this one. And you can see the round like lesion. You can see very with the very one large lesion here. So it is erythema multiform. So it is another condition with the drug induced, or it may be induced by infection also. So you may get a HSV mycoplasma infection associated erythema multiform, or sometimes you get a drugs, all commonly using anticonvulsant and antibiotic also. Okay, this crash. And the neoplasm, we are not seeing much common with the neoplasm leukemia lymphoma, but other condition drugs and the infection we are seeing very commonly. So how to differentiate erythema multiform, major and minor? So erythema multiform minor represents a localized eruption of the skin and no mucous involvement. We already seen it now, the figure. But multiform major means it may be more severe, more involved in skin mucous membrane. So according to the involvement of the body surface area, we can divide into whether it is erythema multiform major group less than 30%. If it is a 10 to 30%, it is a Sjögren-Johnson syndrome. If it is more than 30%, it is a 10, means a toxic epidermoendocolysis. So even though it may minor, may be simple and easy to treat and very good prognosis, 10, it is very severe, and Sjögren-Johnson syndrome also, it is very severe. So here you can see erythema multiform, it is involving some skin here. Here you can see very large target lesion here and a major involving whole body. And Sjögren-Johnson, you can say it is 10 to 30%, more than 30% body is involved. I mean, in the case of 10, it is a whole, more than 10, 30% involvement, very serious skin and mucous membrane involved. So some kind of difference we can see according to the body surface involved, erythema multiform minor, you got 10%, Sjögren-Johnson syndrome overlapping 10 to 30%, 10 it is more than 30%. And a common cause may be infection, but in all these conditions, you have to see this medication. So, any kid. Another thing I got to mention here is that you won't get all this skin reaction immediately after taking the medication. Some anticonvulsant like lamotrigine, it may take 2 to 3 weeks to develop the rash. That is also very important. Today itself, you are taking drug, tomorrow you won't develop it. Mortality also, you can see it is very rare in erythema multiform minor, but in other conditions, then it is 50%. And sickle, It's rare, but it's common. And another important signal you have to keep in mind is that eye involvement. So vision may be impaired. So that is also you have to keep in mind. In addition to other complications, dehydration, infection, sepsis, eye involvement also you have to keep in mind. When you go to our 50 case, child with fever, headache, myalgia, throat, duration. Many cases in the community, that is in this epidemic case, so macular paper rush 3 to 5 days, rush progress to purpuric spot, and the prominent in the extreme subsequently all over the body, and child develop edema, child progressively deteriorated. So child develop fever, rush, macular papilla, and purpuric spot, generalized rush and edema, then child deteriorate. What is the condition? So here you can see the edema very beautifully. You can see the bilateral, and you can see the macular papilla, rash, edema, and you can see that the rash all over the body. Here again, you can see it is some rash including both palmar and the sole also involved. So finally, you can see the rash in the dressed covered area, that is a gluteal region. This is sharp. So diagnosis is very, very easy to make here. One thing I want to point here is that ASHA is commonly around 60% ASHA you can see in the covered area, in the gluteal region, axilla, and other area. So you may miss it. You are just a small lesion, you may miss it. And I'm still remembering my two patients. One here is the ASHA in the gluteal fold, so it is not visible outside. Second one is on the sole. In the leg, in the sole aspect. So we thought, my parents thought it is some injury to the sole. So we have to differentiate because nowadays is very common scar typhus and then tick typhus. I am going to only the skin rash aspects of both this differentiating. So in the rash, it may be transient, skin 40 to 60%, but as a rash is very common in then tick typhus. Anyway, our child had a rash. And ASHRA, it is only 5 to 60% is pathognomonic. If there is ASHRA, we can make it sure. But if it is not there, we cannot rule out it. So in such a case, we have to support with the epidemic and you have to get a diagnosis. ASHRA is comparatively rare, but a rash is common in Indian type. And diagnosis, you have to be alopecia scrub typhus, even though it is a very, very non-specific, but I think it is cheap, easily available, and we can do it, and we can do after 2 weeks also. And you get OS care and your test should be positive, whereas in case of Indian type typhus, it is positive and oxygen, post-19. And other serology is also very ideal, but not easily available. This one, I'll go to next case. I think it is very clear nowadays. We are very familiar with it. You can see the blanching of the skin, very simple. So you can see that white island is surrounded by red sea, which is again very, very classic rash of dengue. Dengue rash, I think you will may get dengue rash, different types of dengue rash. One is you will get this diffuse flushing, which is blanchable. Second one is you will get purpurea and petechia. You have a Hess test and everything, tonic test, everything is important in this aspect. The third one is islands of white in the sea of red, you can see this kind. So in majority cases, you won't get very serious cases, but once in a while, you may get very serious dengue shock syndrome. But in such a case, it may be useful to diagnose with the help of a rash. So here again, you will get a very serious condition, 2-3 condition, once which means infection caused by third spacing. One is dengue, we know, and a recurrent infection may also go for very serious because of the species loss. And it is nowadays, it is very common question, what is involved in skin in COVID area. So in COVID, you will get 8 to 18% you will get skin involvement. And luckily, there is no characteristic skin feature in COVID. None is pathognomonic. You may get different types of, you may get erythematous lattice, you may get urticaria, vascular lesion, petechiae, plantar, and so you may get KD like rash also. So you may get any type of rash in the COVID also, you may get any type of rash. It is another brownish nose pigmentation. I think it is not very common setup, especially in a newborn, say neonate chikungunya. We have seen a lot of cases of chikungunya, but a newborn, I think our experience is not very fine. Compared to chikungunya nowadays, I think it's not very common. Nowadays, very common, but we are seeing this rash, hand, foot, and mouth disease very common. So you can see here vascular rash. And for last 2 years, what we are seeing is some differences that instead of hand, foot, mouth, we are getting elbow, knee joint, and gluteal region. So the area of predominance nowadays, I think what we are seeing Kerala is elbow, knee joint, and gluteal region. And another difference what we observe is we are getting large bullous lesion. sometimes we get here also you can see large bullets here, but sometimes we get confused with chicken pox also. So such a condition also nowadays we are seeing. And one thing, comparatively, we mentioned just comparatively safe disease. We all know it is very safe disease. The only thing is that some children will develop some problem of nail shedding, onycholysis. Otherwise, comparatively easy. But there are so many cases, serious condition reported following enterovirus 7, especially in Hong Kong and China. They are reported some serious condition because usually it is a benign disease with a coxsackie type of virus. But when it is the enterovirus 71, it's more serious. You may get some neurological features in the form of aseptic meningitis, encephalitis, cerebral ataxia, cerebral neoplasia, and a plastic paralysis. And also two deaths reported due to cardiac complications also due to myocarditis. And a fingernail, already mentioned that you may get fingernail or toenail or onycholysis also. So usually it is a benign disease, but when it is due to enterovirus 71, you may get the most. It's another 28-day newborn person with this kind of rash. It's very characteristic. I think you can make a diagnosis 8 day old. That's very important. How will you manage this child? So this is a case of a diffuse chickenpox. When it's a social, when it is 8 days, then you have to think about the maternal infection itself. You have to think about it. So this patient you have to treat with the varicella zoster immunoglobulin. So if the child is less than 2 kg, you can use 125 units. And if it's large, I mean, more than 2 kg, you can use 250 milligrams. And so the person lasts for 3 weeks. And if the immunoglobulin is not available, then you can give, because varicella zoster specific immunoglobulin is not available in all places. And it is was not available in our hospital also. So one patient, we have to give IVIG also. That's a 400 milligram per kg as soon as possible. Preferably within 2 to 3 days you have to give. And also, according to if a child is born between 5 days to 2 days, then that means 5 days before the delivery and 2 days after, then you have to think about injection acyclovir. You have to give 10 milligram per kg per dose, and you have to 3 doses, so that is 30 mg per kg. You have to give total 7 days after the onset of maternal rash, and you have to administer for 10 days. The mother is starting varicella symptom from day 3 to 28. That is well before delivery. Then definitely the child may get a passive transfer of antibody. So it is less serious. In such a case, you need not give immunoglobulin. You can treat the baby with oral acyclovir, 80 milligram per kilogram body weight. That is 20 milligram per kilogram body weight for 6 hours, and you have to give 7 to 10 days. And child develop any serious consequences, then you have to think about any IV isoclovir, and also you have to rule out any immunocompromised condition in such cases. This is another common condition. You can see 5-year-old boy with a high grade fever, sore throat. So I can see a red, the beefy tongue. So you get and also very very characteristic discommission. That is also very important. So such things you have to keep in mind. So when you are getting a febrile exanthem with the discommission, you have to think about scarlet fever and our Kawasaki disease. I think measles also will get a very good discommission, and the septic toxic shock syndrome, either staphylococcus, streptococcus, you'll get again, you get this one, and Stevens-Johnson syndrome, toxic ophthalmon, necrolysis also will get it. So all these conditions you have to keep in mind when you are dealing with a child with the skin rash later discommission. The other child with the 10-year-old boy with the unprovoked seizure before 1 month, start neptoin since then, present with the fever, generalized edema, and intense erythematous rash following period. So he got hepatomegaly and a bilateral cervical lymph node also. So as such, we know the toxicity of heparin involved lymphadenopathy also. In this case, there is a leukocytosis, platelet normal, eosinophil 4%, CRP 3, and ESR slightly high, and STPT elevated. So you can see child with a discommoding rash, diffuse rash following a heparin intake. So you have to think about very rare condition. Drug-related eosinophilia with the symptoms and signs, systemic symptoms and signs. It's a Rush syndrome. I think it is not very commonly seen. I don't know whether we are missing it or we are seeing drug rush with such a condition, but we not usually point them as such a Rush. So drug infection and drug in the skin eruption, in our case, was there. And the blood disturbance, you may get hyper-eosinophilia. In our case, there is an eosinophilia, but a typical lymphocyte was there. A systemic abnormality in the form of enlarged lymph node was there, hepatitis it was there, and interstitial nephropathy, interstitial lung disease, or cardiac. So, Rush syndrome also you have to keep in mind, especially following drug intake. So which is a drug, because it is one of the commonest conditions. How to differentiate from other illness? For a child came with a simple bile fever, when you make some drug, they will develop a rash, so the patient may be very angry. We are also totally confused whether it is bile fever, it is drug in this rash. So very important to differentiate a drug rash from the other systemic illness. So you may get a history of drug history, you may get it, and it may be itchy, and no bile put down, and you get no fever also in drug rash, and there will be really good response to antihistamine. Rash can be any type of rash, may get articulated, generalized, macular, papular, macular, any type of rash may get, and it can be life-threatening also. And the important aspect of the treatment is that you have to risk any drug may produce a drug rash, so be aware about it. And as I already mentioned, you need not get rash immediately, you may get after 1, 2, 3 weeks also. And you have to discontinue drug symptomatic treatment. So thank you for the patient care. Over to Dr. Arvind Kumar. Kumar sir, good afternoon.
Yeah, one question about Dress syndrome. Sometimes fever with Dress syndrome sometimes comes with high fever, especially because of drugs. You would like to mention something about it, sir? Rash and
I think we have come across in Dress, we have, but specifically diagnosing it as a Dress, because pediatrics are not very much aware about Dress syndrome. But the treatment, it won't make any fever with when you are treating, we are getting high grade fever, rash, it may be Dress. But treatment as such, there's no different treatment. You have to give antihistaminic and supportive measures. We not usually make a diagnosis of Dress symptom as such. I think very rare. Only it is
because especially, children with this thing, some antibiotics or this thing, anti-tuberculosis drugs, they get it. Yeah. Thank you.
Dr. Baldev, yes.
Sir, unmute, sir. Baldev, sir, unmute.
Sorry, I think now audible. Yeah. What actually I wanted to make the comment on the Dress syndrome, I have personally came across the 3 patients. And very interesting, one patient, which was on an antibiotic drug before 2 months, started with a fever, then some rashes, lymphadenopathy, child there of the jaundice, child has some renal involvement, and the way in which even these so many dermatologists, nephrologists, gastroenterologists were in the picture. And even I personally mentioned during that time, there was the occasion of my daughter's marriage. So I said that I will not be able to come to see the patient. But my student was pediatric, he insisted